أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين. Let's continue inshallah where we left off with the poetry. And today is a little heavy lecture because of the rulings that we're going to be studying inshallah. But it's as important because we all go through it in our life and we need to understand it. So the Sheikh said, وَاغْتُفِرَ الْكَاذِبُ بِالزِّيَادَةِ مُبَالِغًا بِمُسْتَحِيلٍ عَادًا. Yeah, we spoke about this. He said, it is permissible to lie using a figure of speech if that was impossible. And remember, we said that over exaggerating in statements, like saying, I called you a million times. You never called a million times. So that's not, the Arab doesn't consider that as a lie. They consider it as impossible to happen. So the exaggeration here is not a form of a lie. Okay, if the person exaggerates. But if a person says, Wallahi, I called you, or I called you 6 times or 7 times, that's possible. Or 20 times, that's possible. But a million is, it's impossible. قَالَ وَعِنْدَمَا يُخْشَى نُفُورُ وَلَدِي أَوْ زَوْجَةٍ جَازَ ارْتِكَابُ الْفَنَةِ. He said, it's permissible to lie when one fears the the estray of a child or a wife. We spoke about this before. If the purpose of lying is to reconcile or to fix a situation or to bring a benefit that is clear benefit, then it's permissible with the intention that this lie is to bring in that benefit. قال لكن بلا تمسح لأخذ ما ليس له أو منع أو منع حق له. He said, but it's not with a condition that when you do that, meaning when you start, when you lie for whatever reason, the condition is that you do not take someone's right or prevent someone's right. Okay, so when it comes to that, taking someone's right or preventing a person's right, then here lying does not, lying is not permissible and there is no justification that a person would lie. That's the condition. قال وإن تعين طريقا لكذب عن بدن أو مال أو عقد كذب. He said, if the only way to protect one's life, wealth, or dignity is by lying, then one must do so. If a person would have is forced to lie, okay, because they are preventing one of the five, the most sacred, the most honored are five. In our life, do we know what they are? We study them in usul al-fiqh. Yes, protecting your nafs, your soul. Your nafs comes first. Okay, two. What's the first thing? Life. Deen or nafs? So your soul first or your deen? We need someone to investigate that. That's a homework right now. And nafs with deen? Wal ird, your honor. Wal mal, your wealth. والنسل, your lineage. These five are the most, these are called the five sacred protected. Meaning you if you have to risk one, then that's the order. So the first thing is a nafs, your soul, or a deen. Okay, you need to investigate it. So he said here, if you're lying to protect your nafs, okay, or badan, your soul or your nafs, your honor or your wealth, then you could lie. And subhanAllah, if he's saying you could lie, meaning it's permissible to lie for you to be protected if there is certain harm, like if you're certain that there is harm. So certainty is a must. Here, the problem is that a person must be certain that they are under harm. That's the first thing. And what if, and knowing that if they don't lie, it's not haram. Meaning if they say the truth and something happened to them, they didn't put themselves into harm. But it's better to prevent oneself from harm. But subhanAllah, as we said in the from the hadith, it shows that being honest and being truthful will save you more than lying. Believe it or not, there's a story of Al-Hasan, rahimahullah ta'ala, one of them, and when they were young, his mother sent him on a caravan, on a trip for to study knowledge. And she gave him 100 dinar. And she told him, she said, أُوصِيكَ بِأَمْرًا. I will advise you of two things, okay? Number one, تَقْوَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَالْإِخْلَاصِ فِي الْعَبْدِ. First, you fear Allah and you become sincere in your action that you seek no other reward but the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, she said, you shouldn't lie at all. Don't lie. Train yourself to never lie. He said, okay. When they left, there were thieves on the roads, okay? They stopped the caravan. They wanted to take their money from them. So they came to Saeed or Hassan. They asked them, they said, so they asked everybody, do you have anything with you? So people start saying, no, I don't. So they searched them up. When they came to him, and he said, the leader, he said to him, he said, do you have anything to give? And he was 12 or 13 or so, very young. He said, yes, I have 100 dinar. So he looked at him and he said, yeah, you're joking now with me? And then he left. And he thought he was mocking him. He's like, a kid has 100 dinar. Why would a kid has 100 dinar? So he left. So they asked him, they said, do you really have 100 dinar after they left? He said, yeah, he's the only one who saved his money. So they told him, you were not afraid that when you said you have 100 dinar that he would take it from you? He said, وَعَدْتُ أُمِّي, I promised my mother not to lie because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الصدق نجاة. Truthful or being truthful is a way of success or a way of to save yourself. It will save you. And subhanAllah, it did. If he lied, they would have searched him up just to make sure he has money or not. So these are the conditions just to prevent one's harm or to be prevented from harm. قَالَ وَالْخُلْفُ إِنْ يُرَجْ بِهِ صَلَاحٌ لِلْبَيْنِ هَلْ يُنْدَبُ أَوْ يُبَاحُ. He said there is a difference among the scholars in, okay, what they differ on what? If it's hoped that by lying one will rectify between two people, there is a difference of opinion whether it's recommended or that is permissible. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he said, لَيْسَ الْكَذَّابُ الَّذِي يُصْلِحُ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ فَيَنْمِي خَيْرًا أَوْ يَقُولُ خَيْرًا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, hadith narrated by Bukhari and Muslim, one who is not a liar is a person who tried to reconcile between people or rectify between people, okay? And his intention is to do good or to say good. So he's not a liar. That means he did lie to rectify. He did lie to reconcile. So his reason was to reconcile between people. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that person is not considered to be a liar because his intention of his statement or even his action is the outcome is good. And of course, reconciling between people is one of the best ibadat. One of the best ibadat that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned in many of the hadith. Because it brings in peace and tranquility, enmity and hatred. And people nowadays, they fight on anything. Like they argue and they have enmity and they carry hate toward one another just for the little small things. So imagine now, you know, when something big happens. So that's not considered to be a lie. وَلَهُمْ فِي الْكُرْهِ وَالْحِرْمَانِ قَوْلَانِ رَاجِحَانِ فِي الْأَيْمَانِ. Now this is the topic. He said, وَلَهُمْ, there are two opinions among the scholars in regards to swearing an oath by other than the name of Allah. So this is the first part. Now we're going to talk about swear. An oath is something that you swear upon either for affirmation or for denial. And an oath is using a statement that has a form of swear by whatever that is. So he's going to talk about all these conditions now, and we'll talk about more into the fiqh perspective, inshallah. He said there are two difference. There's two opinions among the scholars in swearing an oath with other than Allah, yani by anything that is other than Allah. So we actually have three opinions in this case. We have among the scholars three opinions. One, that it's not allowed, period. Okay. Two, that is permissible by swearing or taking an oath by something that is great or sacred that is connected to Allah. Three, that it is permissible at all. So which one is more accurate here? Let's explain first. So the first one says nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names or attributes. Okay, you swear by Allah's name, you swear by Allah's attribute, you know, his beautiful names, any of that, that's permissible. Other than that, no. We have people who swear every culture is different. Mathan, talking about people who speak Arabic, they swear by the Prophet. You guys do that too? No? Alhamdulillah. Yeah, they swear by the Prophet, they swear by their mother, they swear by their father, they swear by their wife. Oh, why would they swear by their wife? No, I never heard it, that's why I'm they swear by their life, okay? They swear by the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of that. All of this is not permissible. That's the first opinion. Second opinion says, look what you swear upon. For example, if a person swears by al-Kaaba, is that permissible or not? Al-Kaaba is sacred. Can we swear by al-Kaaba? Yeah? No? No, we see that. So they said if it's related to Allah, yani if it's something that is sacred, then we should, if it's connected to Allah, it's al-Kaaba is created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth and so on and so forth. So people honor it, so we could swear by it. That's a second opinion. So your father's head, with all the respect, is not honorable, meaning it's not sacred. So you can't swear by your father's head or by his. We have that in Arabic. In Arabic, there is a lot. We have people who swear by everything. يعني يقول لك there was a guy in Egypt. He was the mayor of a city. So people, he loved his dog so much, and he honored it so much. So people used to swear by the honor of his dog so they could get a benefit from him. Believe it or not. To a point that some, you know, there's a known joke at that. There was a person who, there was a person, he gave a fatwa that owning a dog or raising a dog in a house is not permissible, because the angels would not enter the house, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the hadith. The angel does not enter a house that has a statue or a dog. This is very clear. So he used to speak very bad of the dog. So when the dog died, the mayor made a janazah for the dog. Like a janazah gathering and condolence and everything. So this person came out to speak about this. This is wrong. So before he started, the mayor told him, he said, the dog left 100K. And he mentioned your name in their inheritance. So the sheikh said, may Allah have mercy on him. What did he say? Anyway, people change. Money changes everything. Allah Musta. Why did we get into the dog? Huh? Oh, swear. Okay, swear. So the third opinion that is not permissible at all that is permissible at all. Okay, to be honest, that the most accurate, correct opinion that we are commanded not to swear by other than Allah, and this is what I hold as an opinion, to be honest, because swearing, we could swear by al-Kaaba and make it honorable, and instead of saying by al-Kaaba, we could say by what? The Lord of al-Kaaba. We still honor the Kaaba, but we added on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of al-Kaaba. Samawat wal-Ard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he swore by as-samawat wal-Ard. Okay, we could swear by the Lord of heaven and earth. Why? Because when we swear by something, we are glorifying it. We are honoring it. And honoring something has to be, we have to have evidence for it. So the only one who's allowed to swear by other than or by anything is Allah. Because Allah swore by al-duha, Allah swore by al-fajr, Allah swore by al-asr, Allah swore by al-shams, Allah swore by so many things. It's his creation. He could swear by whatever he wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala wa bihamdih. But we only are allowed to swear by what we're commanded. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, man kana, he said, do not swear by your parents or your forefathers. That's what they used to do. Whoever's swearing, if you have to swear, yani if it's better not to swear on something. But if you have to, فَمَنْ كَانَ حَالِفًا فَلْيَحْلِفْ بِاللَّهِ, you should only swear by Allah, أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ, or you should shut it, keep it quiet. So we know from this hadith that whoever swears by other than Allah, and there's another hadith, whoever swears by other than Allah, فَقَدْ أَشْرَكْ. أَشْرَكْ here means that he had associated a partner with Allah in that form of ibadah. Swear is a form of ibadah, yes. Because when we swear, this is a part of ibadah. We are showing Allah that He is our witness for the action that we want to do, that we will either do it or stay away from. Okay? So you understand this part? So that's the correct opinion, inshallah. قَالَ بِغَيْرِهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ أَحَلَّ ذَلِكَ بَعْضُهُمْ بِمَا الشَّرْعُ أَجَلَّ. He said, some of them said, no. Go ahead. Huh? Same thing. The scholars who says that they allowed that, they will say, if you swear by the Quran is glorified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, it is permissible. And because we're in the class of knowledge, we have to present everything. Okay? I don't agree with that personally. But the ones who says that, they restrict it to things that are glorified by Allah. Not anything, so they don't allow. So the Quran for them will be yes. For me, will be no. Like for not me personally. I'm talking about the opinion that I believe or follow. Mashallah. Any question? Okay. The one? Yeah, that's an issue that the ulama differ on it, because here they're afraid of two things: taking an oath upon the Quran, where you put your hand on the Quran and you swear on it. Are you swearing upon the Quran as a witness, or you're swearing upon the honoring of the Quran? It's different. If you're making the Quran to witness, that's not accurate, because the Quran cannot witness in that case. But if you're swearing for honoring for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to witness that you're saying the truth, they differ on that too. It's a big discussion. Restraining from it is better. Allah. قال أما به جل فلا يختار إهماله رأسا ولا الإكثار. He said, now what is the ruling? What is أيمان? What is swearing? Okay, what is an oath? You have to understand that. What is an oath? An oath is to affirm something by mentioning the name of Allah or the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? And it's called in Arabic what? Ayman. What is this word reminds you of? Yameen. Yameen. Okay? So why is it called Ayman? Al-Halif is the same thing. Halif is a swear. Al-Ayman is more affirmation upon and accuracy. Al-Halif was swear, any swear. Like in Al-Ayman is swearing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or his attributes. So what they used to do before, if they want to affirm something, they'll put their hand together. Okay, they'll say, like, shake hands. In English, what do they do? The pinky promise. That's it. It actually has a reference to that. That's so. What they used to do before is that they would shake hand, so hand in hand, okay, and they would affirm that. And usually, the right hand is always the strongest hand. Majority of people. If you're lefty, that's a different story. But in general, so the word yamin came from that. Yamin means right hand. Okay. So is it permissible to swear? That's the first part. The rule is, yes, it is permissible if there's a need. And we're going to talk about the difference between swears now, the different oath that the person could take. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا يؤخذكم الله باللغو في أيمانكم. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not hold you responsible for the false swear or the swear that is lagu, that is nonsense. Okay? But what you affirm. So, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he used to swear, and the Sahaba radwanullahi alayhim, they swear upon things. And the Quran itself used to swear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la'amruka, by your life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by, like we mentioned, heaven and earth and other things. So it is permissible when there is a need. The category of swear, that's what we care about to mention. Number one, we have something called al-yamin al-mun'aqida. Yamin al-mun'aqida is an affirmed swear that there's two types, that you will do something or you will restrain from something, okay? And you affirm that by swearing upon it. So for example, you will say, wallahi la akul al-haram, wallahi I will not eat haram. And then you eat haram. Or you will say, wallahi, I am not doing this. And then you do that. That is called yamin what? Mun'aqida. Mun'aqida means you affirmed it with certainty that you will do it. And then you went against it. We'll talk about what's the kafar expiation on that. Now, al-yamin al-ghamus. Yamin al-ghamus means a swear that you dip yourself in it. And it's called the dipping swear or oath because the person is causing himself to be dipped into hellfire because of that swear, which is swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intentionally to lie or without certainty. So, مثلا, you ask him, did you take this? Well, wallahi, I didn't take it. And he is lying. هذا يسمى يمين غموس. Okay? Or the person is doubting. He's not sure and he still swears. He says, wallahi, I'm not sure. مثلا, you say, did you take money from someone? Like a debt? He says, wallahi, I never took money from him. And he's lying. So what did he do here? He committed two problems. What? The lying and the swearing. Okay, so he's sinning for both, for lying and swearing by Allah subhanahu for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, al-kaba'ir, major sins, is to associate a partner with Allah, okay, to disrespect your parents, to kill a soul, and to falsely swear. Al-yamin al-ghamus. It's a major sin. It's not a joke. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the surah. Now we have the third category of swear, which is al-yaminul-laghu. Yaminul-laghu is the swear of speech that is not meant to affirm anything or to deny anything. It's just a matter of a person using the swear for in his regular talk. That has to do with an intention. If he's doing it out of disrespect to the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's doing it just for the sake of affirming everything that he's saying, just to be accurate, whether not lying or not lying, that's not permissible. But if it's a form of speech, then he should lessen that, okay? But it's not haram, and there's nothing wrong with it, and there's no expiation on that kafara. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam used to swear to the Sahaba, and there is no need for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam to swear because the Sahaba believes him without swearing. And he didn't need to affirm anything to the Sahaba. Now, So swearing by Allah, if you're gonna do it, then you have to be sure that what you're saying is correct, and you have to also be sure that what you're saying, that you will do what you're saying. Because if you don't, then you have an expiation. Okay, this is very important. And of course, there is a divorce swear. A lot of people do that. I don't know if it's in English, if it's common in English, but it's very common in Arabic. Is it common in your language? Yeah. What is it called? No, not li'an. Not li'an. Li'an is different. Li'an is to curse one another back and forth, or to say that the person, she's no longer divorce, swearing by divorce. Huh? They wallahi al-azim, I had a person, I am sure he divorced his wife 1,000,000 times. And I'm sure at least three of them are 100. Why? Because he used to swear by divorce for everything. For example, if he invites you for tea, he's, I swear by you, you have to drink. Like, you don't need, not a big deal. He swears by divorce, like he says, talaq, and he always says, talaq thalath, or alayya talaq, like, I swear by divorce, alayya talaq. That's the Arabic terminology. You say, I swear by divorce that you will do this. Well, hold on, because if the person doesn't do it, the wife will be what? Divorced. It's not. You know, subhanAllah, I heard an opinion from one of the scholars that was very weird, very strange. I don't believe it's accurate, but I believe it's good to use. He says, if a person is continuously swearing by divorce, when he gets married, it counts as one. Like, khalas, we deposit one divorce for him for sure. If he's swearing by divorce before marriage, okay? And then he can, because not just swearing by divorce, people do it, wallahi al-azim, for the weirdest thing. So sometimes you have to fulfill the person. I was crossing by a house in Egypt, and this person, he said, and then he said, come inside. I said, wallahi, I'm very busy. Alayya al-talaq, I swear upon divorce, lazim tut, we have to go inside. So I went inside, then I stepped out. Because you fulfilled his, they don't mean divorce. They actually don't mean divorce. But the problem here, that divorce does not need what? Intention. Why is this so surprising? I thought this is. There's Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Thalathun jidduhunna jidd." أو اثنتان في الحديث جدهن جد وهزلهن جد. He said three things that when you say it, whether you're joking or you're serious, it counts as serious. Huh? Marriage. There's no joking about marriage. You can't go and say to someone, would you like to marry me? She said, yes, I accept. Or that. Then you're like, oh, sorry, I was just joking. About. There's no joking. It's affirmed. Okay? It's not a joke. Rasulullah said that. He said the joke of it and being serious about it is the same. One, two, huh? Divorce. There's no joke about divorce. So when we say divorce doesn't need an intention, meaning what? Meaning just saying the actual wording of divorce, not the conditional divorce. Okay, let me explain to you. I know most of you are not married, which is good. No, I mean good. I'm not going to explain, but I mean, yani, good you're not married now to learn, yani, that's what I mean. Give me one sec. So, if a person, you made me forget what I wanted to say. Yes, divorce. There's a conditional divorce. If a person says to his wife, you are divorced if you leave the house. Here, he made it as a conditional. Now, this is the time we ask him, your intention was what? Really? You wanted to divorce her if she leaves? Or you just threatening her not to leave? He will say, well, I never meant divorce. I was just saying it because majority of the scholars will say, okay, that's not divorce because his intention is what's considered now. Okay? But now if they're arguing or they're fighting and then he says to her that you are divorced. Now he cannot, you cannot come and say, what was your intention? There is no intention in that case because he used the word divorce, talaq, literal explicit meaning. So if he put a condition or he makes it like a condition, then we could ask him for an intention, okay? Or if he's in a state of anger that he cannot remember what he said and he followed it by regret. Like he really, because honestly, I know you're not, most of you are not married, but honestly, nobody ever divorced when they're playing cards and joking and laughing. I have not heard of two people watching TV and they're laughing at, and then he looks at her and says, oh, you're divorced. That doesn't, never happens. So when you say, I was angry, what divorce is a divorce of, what's divorce? Is a separation because of an argument or a problem. It has to be, anger has to be involved, unless it's conditioned. Okay, so back to where we're going. That charge. It's gonna die. So now, swearing upon divorce, as we said, let's just back to swearing because we don't want to go into the slave. What is the expiation now? If a person does a kafara, he wants to do an expiation, or a swear that he cannot fulfill, or a vow that he cannot fulfill. What's the expiation? One by one. لا يؤخذكم الله باللغو في أيمانكم ولكن يؤخذكم بما عقدتم الأيمان فكفارته. Now the expiation. Listen now to the expiation. One. إطعام عشرة مساكين. That you feed, and this is very important. A lot of people, when they tell you, I swear, they run after and they say, oh, I'll just fast 3 days. No, that's not correct. Fasting 3 days is not correct kafara. Or they will tell you, oh, just swear and fast 3 days. No, who said fast 3 days? Allah said the expiation for kafaratu, feeding 10 needy from the best food that you and your family eat from, or clothing them and providing clothes for them. For a man, one thob is enough. For women, a thob and a khimar. Or freeing a slave. If you can find, then what? Then fast 3 days. So here, we can't jump to 3 days before we fulfill the first. Taban, from the first three, we don't have the freeing slave no more. That doesn't exist. So we have one of two. Now, how much of a good meal that is for you and your family to eat in a day? $4, what do you eat? What do you eat? What's... Oh, 4x4. I thought you said $4. I'll be worried who's going to marry you now. Going to feed them $4. No, seriously, how much is a good meal for you and your family? So 20, so we'll say $20, okay? It's okay, let her. I enjoy kids' voice, but not adult voices, with all the respect. I don't have a problem kids shouting and screaming, but I feel like you guys are talking in my head. Seriously, okay, back to the swear. The kafara, one, you feed 10 people, so $20 times 10? $200, okay? So that's $200 as kafara. For one swear. Or clothing them. How much a thobe would be? about $30, $40 or so. So you would multiply that. If you don't find, so do you have $200 to pay or no? Yes, you cannot fast 3 days. You cannot just say, oh, I'm not going to pay that $200 too much, even though you have it, and I'm just going to go and jump and fast 3 days. You cannot do that. So understanding the kafara is very important because people, it's like you're fulfilling an obligation without the requirement. You don't get a reward. You didn't fulfill it. Like zakah, for example. A lot of people, how much you have to give zakah? 2.5 from an estimate number, about $3,500 or so, if you have it for 1 year, okay? What if a person just gives $100 and he says, I'm just going to consider it as zakah? We say, good, you did give something, but you didn't get anything for it. You didn't get reward for it. You didn't fulfill the obligation for it. Kafara is the same thing, okay? So anybody who tells you from now on, I'll just fast 3 days, you tell them no. You need to do the steps. So which one is better, to feed, to clothe, or to free a slave? There is no better here because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said aw. Aw means what? Or. So or here is a choice. Huh? Because he said, فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ. He said, okay, the kafara is you feed 10 or you clothe them or you free a slave. If you can't find, that means what? First three first. If you don't find, then you move on to fasting 3 days. Okay? Fasting 3 days for every square. Yes.
What if, let's say
you cannot afford,
like, carrying 200, and you have more than
200. Too much. Yeah, that's why it's called kafara. The word kafara came from the hardship to cover. So kafara is a form of punishment for what you're doing. Okay, why is it kafara? I know it's too much. The reason here is to push you not to do it. So the kafara is to prevent you from falling into the haram. For example, مثلاً, it's the case with everything. Okay, why do we cut the hand of a thief? So he doesn't steal, and people shouldn't steal. We're trying to prevent. So when you say it's too much, you are the one who caused yourself to fall into that. La majority of the scholars, the Hanafi, the Shafi'i, Maliki, and Hanbali, majority of them says that you should find a needy person to provide food for, like one person or 10 people, okay, or clothe them, better than giving them money, because the kafara literally says what? إطعام عشرة مساكين أو كسوتهم, or so you can't provide money. So that 200 you have to give. Yes. MashaAllah. There is a website that says that? Like pay $25 and it... could be that they're doing that because they are an organization that runs... They could take the opinion of the Ahnaf on that and some of the Shafi'i. Yeah, they could take... There is an opinion. I'm not saying this haram. Saying what is better when it comes to expiation is that you fulfill the expiation the way it is. Let me speak about something here. Everybody, mashallah. Let me speak about something here that is important. What did I want to say? I can't remember what I wanted to say. Today I'm not in the loop. Yeah? Yeah, but what did I want to say? Yes, yes. Yes, yes. Because that says this, then that, yes. So here, the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to understand this part, and this is a very important point. The deen of Allah, the legislation, the commands are not by desire. Meaning what? Meaning, look at this. Allah says, zakah of money is 2.5. We cannot come and say something better. Zakah of money has to be given as money. Now, when it comes to zakatul fitr, he specified food. When it comes to kafara, he says feed. When it comes to the other kafara, he said fast. So everything has a rule. We cannot just start mixing things up because we just want to make it easy. Udhiyah. Okay? I am going to slaughter 100 chicken. Why? Because it's easier to distribute and people love chicken more. Sorry, you didn't fulfill the udhiyah. You slaughter, which is good. But this slaughter doesn't fulfill the obligation. This could be a sadaqah, but not what, because Allah commanded you to slaughter one of the three animals, cattle, camels, or sheep. Yeah, one of the three. Camel, the cattle, all the category. Okay, camels, male and female, she camel and male camel. We cannot come and say, how about I slaughter a gorilla, مثلا. It has more meat. Okay, regardless, it has more meat or not more meat. This is not the point. The deen didn't say slaughter what has more meat. Now, when it comes to aqiqah, what is aqiqah? Slaughtering a goat or a sheep or two for a boy or a girl, two for a boy and one for a girl. Like, can I come and say it is better? See, this is the point. It's better to slaughter a cow than a sheep. Yes, it is better in a sense of more meat. Good. But what is better here in this case is what? A sheep. Because this is what you're commanded of. So when you say better, you can't make that decision. You cannot just say, I'll just give them money because it's better for them. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, were there poor people who needed money or no? Yes? Okay. Did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi ever told the Sahaba to give money to the poor people or no? Yeah, he did. Many times. Why, when it came zakatul fitr, he specified food? Because money is better for the poor. Well, it was better for the poor back then too. Money is better at all times. Gold and silver is the currency. You understand that part? So we have to follow. If you really want to fulfill the deen, you have to do it. Like we don't do it, alhamdulillah, so far. We don't have anybody yet who's saying, why do we pray Maghrib 3 that time? Alhamdulillah, nowadays we have air condition, we have fans, we have light. You know, they used to pray 3 because it was dark and they run all excuses. Okay, how about we pray Maghrib 6? To be honest, just think about this. Which one is better, 6 rak'ah or 3 rak'ah? 6 rak'ah. Why don't you pray 6? Because the 3 is the Maghrib. We have to. So, see, this has to, yani the same rule you used here, the same ruling you made for yourself here, is the same ruling you make for the obligations. Okay? So, that's about the kafara. Let's move on from the kafara. I think you guys swear too much. Maybe that's why. Now. فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ if you cannot afford. You don't have it and you cannot afford it. Then you pay the 200. Yes, sir. Good luck with you. Kafara is the punishment. You have to think of that way. Not a punishment. It's a purification for the sin, but it's also a warning. It's a form of, like, you know, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the meaning of the hadith, because I can't recall the hadith exactly. He said, an oath or a vow is a way of Allah to take money from those who are cheap. I think that's, I just can't recall the exact wording of the hadith. إِنُّ النَّذْرِ يُؤْخَذُ مِنَ الْبَخِيلِ or something like that. يعني the vow, when somebody says, مثلا, if I pass my class, I'm going to slaughter a camel. This is what? A vowel. You have to fulfill it. Okay? You pass your class, especially if you affirm it, you say, Wallahi, if I pass my class. Okay? Now, this person comes and says, no, man, camel is too much. That's like $20,000. Yeah, the guy in Dubai just bought a she camel that is very rare. 2 million dirham, yeah, believe it or not. I was so shocked. I think it was close to like a million some dollar, and I was like, Umar al-Khattab, he said, when they told him, why don't we cover the Kaaba with cloth that is made from silk and to make the cover of the Kaaba? He said, the body of the Muslims are in more need to be covered than the Kaaba. The stomach of the children is in more need of feeding than to cover al-Kaaba. This guy going to get a camel in an auction. So anyway, the Rasulullah said the vowel is the way of Allah taking money from people who are cheap. Meaning what? Because the person, when he said, I'm going to slaughter a camel, he actually didn't mean a camel. What he meant is just to swear upon something. You have to fulfill it. And that's what Rasulullah said, An-nadhru la ya'ti bi khayr. A vowel does not bring goodness to you. You shouldn't make a vowel. If you have to, then you should leave it open. So for example, Wallahi, if I pass my class, I'm going to do something good. Now, what could be good? Two rak'ah, sadaqah, playing with the baby here. She's something good. Wallah, anything is good. Slaughtering a goat or a sheep or a chicken or a goat or a camel, or it doesn't matter. Okay? But when you specify, you're limiting your options. You say, Wallahi, I'm slaughtering a horse, a white horse. You cannot slaughter a black horse. It has to be a white horse. People do that. They specify too much that they start causing themselves problems. Rasulullah said, vowel will never bring you goodness. Why? Because you might not be able to fulfill it. When Abdul Muttalib made a vow, what was his vow? He said, if Allah bless me with 10 children, I'm going to do what? Slaughter one of them. So when Allah blessed him with 10, he wanted to slaughter one. Who that choice was? Abdullah, the father of Rasulullah. He loved him so much. By the way, Abdul Muttalib was willing to sacrifice one of his children, no problem. But the problem was Abdullah. It's not, the problem was he loved him. He could not do it because he wanted other options. So he ended up doing what? He ended up slaughtering camels. Huh? 100 camel for him to sacrifice for his son. So don't ever make a swear or an oath or a promise or a vow that you cannot keep or you think you can't keep, because it's either haram or there's a kafar. Understand that part? Any question on that now? I will stop here to take questions and answers, and maybe the brothers and sisters who are online, if they want to join too with questions, because they always say we don't pay attention to them. Yes? It depends on what you say. Like, you'll do what? Like, what's the example? If you specify, that's a vow. That's a nadhr. If you say, if I am blessed with a child, if I'm blessed with a child, I will slaughter an animal. That's a vow. But what's good about it is you didn't specify. So slaughtering an animal could be any animal. Hatta a pigeon. It's an animal. Yeah, it is. It is permissible, but it's not recommended. No.
Sheikh, sometimes we say inshallah, we know that we may not, you know.
The ulama says that the best of swear to keep yourself safe is the one that you follow by insha'Allah. Say, wallahi, I will meet you tomorrow, insha'Allah. The insha'Allah is an excuse for not fulfilling if you can't, and there's no expiation. Huh? A lot of people... But you cannot do inshallah on the things that are haram, for example. يعني مثلا, you say, wallahi, I will not drink alcohol, inshallah. Because you can't do that. The haram is haram, whether you keep the exceptions or not. So yes, that's a good way to protect your oath if it's something that you can't do. So one. Now. Yeah. If she forgives you, that's a different story, but it's a vow. Rasulullah said you should fulfill your vows, and the most important vows are the ones you make with Allah, especially with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is the king of Rome, the Roman Empire, when he heard the ayat of Surah Alif Lam Mim, غُلِبَتُ الرُّومِ فِي أَدْنَى الْأَرْضِ وَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ غَلَبِهِمْ سَيَغْلِبُونَ, he said, I swear if we gain victory and we defeat the Persians, I will walk to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and barefooted. And he did, because they have to fulfill the vow. So the point of the vow here is if you have to, just try not to restrict it too much. Try not to say... Just leave it open. Inshallah, if I pass my finals, inshallah, I will offer a salah. That salah could be Maghrib, Isha, Fajr, 2 rak'ah. But if you say, I will pray 100 rak'ah, you put yourself in trouble. Because as soon as you pass, you have to fulfill 100 rak'ah. And most people can do 100 rak'ah. So what are you going to do now? You're going to consider it as kaffaratu yameen. You're going to consider it as expiation, as a swear. You have to either feed 10 or clothe them. Yeah, the 4x4 that Hazim mentioned. And you said what? With what? With animal fries. No.
Two questions. One is the three things that you mentioned is the nikah, the divorce. What is the third thing that...
What's the third thing? Huh? Yameen. The swear, the oath.
Okay. And the second question is that if... I think we didn't finish the whole thing is that if someone says the three divorces or 1, 2, and 3 while he's in a state of like anger, is it counted as is, or is it counted as can he take his?
Yeah, if a person divorces his wife in the same gathering,
that's one question. The second is
no, it has to be a thing. If a person says to his wife that she is divorced 3 times in the same gathering, that counts as one. If he says to her that she's divorced and he leaves and he comes back and he says she's divorced and he leaves, or he says it, then they got married again, then after a while he says it again, then after a while he says, that's three. So the three is not, it has to be in separated gatherings, not in the same gathering. And he has to be in a full, you know, I discussed it with a lot of the scholars and mashayikh, and I'm not very convinced of the anger part, because I don't know who divorces when he's not angry. Seriously, like you can't, because the level of anger is different, of course. You know the anger that Rasulullah said, لا طلاق في إغلاق, there is no divorce when the person is completely sealed. Meaning what? Meaning as soon as he's out, خلاص, somebody, she will say to him, you know that you said I was divorced? He will say, me? Wallah, I never said it. She'll say, no, you did say it. He said, oh, I was that angry that I even said, that's someone who can't even, it's like someone who's drunk. He doesn't know what he's doing. When you get to that level of anger, so the problem with divorce here, it needs a lot of specification. Like, what's the other thing? That's it. Yes. No. Yes. The what? Yeah, that's haram. That's haram. Yeah. That's making dua against yourself, not just swearing. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا تدعوا على أنفسكم. Don't swear or make dua against yourself. ولا على أبنائكم النار against your children لعله أن تصيب أحدكم قبول دعوته يعني that one of you would be that it will happen that your dua will be at the time of the acceptance of the dua and it will be accepted then you regret so if you have to say you say ya Allah if you have to you say ya Allah ya Allah اللهم أحييني ما دامت الحياة خيرا لي وأمتني ما دام الموت راحة لي you say ya Allah keep me alive as long as the life is good for me or take my soul back if death is better for me away from the fitna that's the only thing you're allowed to but to say that that's yeah, not we have that against children all the time the mother will say go may Allah destroy you then the person goes we had a well-known friend subhanallah he finished his exam he had exam high school exam and his father so he went to his father he wanted the car keys to go out with his friends so his father said no he kept saying you know begging him for it his father said no at the end of all this his mother convinced the father to give him the key he said here take the keys I hope that he never returns may Allah take him or something like that by Fajr time they got the news they waited for him all night by Fajr time he had a car accident four people in the car with him all the four who were in the car came out of the accident completely safe no scratch he's the only one who died it was a dua of his father the dua of his father what happened it's what happened the doors of Jannah are open sometime for dua subhanallah Allah out of his mercy he opens doors for us so dua could go on the problem is you might make a dua at a time that the doors are open because there's a lot of people who make dua against their children nothing happened mashallah they're good it's just that it didn't get accepted the worry is here is we don't know when is it going to get accepted when it's not yes Again, if you make a dua that you will pray 100 rak'ah, okay? You fulfill it? Of course. You get reward for fulfilling the vow and you get reward for the action. Yes. Go ahead. Yes. To reverse it might be too late. They just do istighfar, but it might be too late. If she says, matter if the mother or the father says, may Allah, you know the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ says the hadith of Wallahi al-Azim, I cannot think of a thing today. For some reason, I'm completely out. The hadith is Jurayj al-Abid. Jurayj was a worshipper. When his mother came to call him, you know, the hadith says he came. His mother came to him. He was in his tree house where he built to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she came to him. She says, oh, Jurayj, I'm your mother. Talk to me. So he was praying sunnah salah. He was praying salah. So he said to himself, oh, Allah, my salah or my mother. And he chose the salah. So his mother left. She came back after a while. She said, oh, Jurayj, I'm your mother. Respond to me. So he said, ya Allah, my prayers or my mother. He chose his prayers. Third time she came, she said, oh, Jurayj, talk to me. So he said, oh, Allah, my... So his mother said, Allahumma la tumithu hatta turiyahu wujuha al-munisat. He said, oh Allah, do not take his soul till he is exposed to females who does wrong or haram. Okay. Just to be exposed to قال أبو هريرة said, if she made dua against him to fall into the fitna, he would have fallen into the fitna. She only said, Ya Allah, expose him to that fitna, but don't make him fall into like, وَالْعَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ falling into the haram with the, those females. But she said that he would, because he's a worshipper, those females usually runs in the streets. Okay, they have their own house. They, at that time, they had houses known of, وَالْعَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ prostitutions and other. It was known like that. They, even in Mecca, this were, they had like red flags on the house. So people, when they come, they know that this is a house. To do it like now, nightclubs, same thing. It's like that. So she said, may Allah expose you, because he was away from everything. He was a worshipper, a great man. So when he didn't respond to his mother made dua against him. She said, Ya Allah, expose him. Abu Hurairah said, if she said, Ya Allah, make him fall into it, he would have done the haram. And he did. He was exposed to the fitna. And, a long story, maybe we could mention it later, inshallah. Last question. Yes.
This question is for you. Are the parents' dua always accepted? Say, I pray for my children.
Inshallah, parents' dua are the reason of acceptance. Yeah, they are. If you want your dua to be accepted, let your parents make it for you. Inshallah, it will be accepted. For you or against you. That's the problem. That's why we should be careful of our parents' dua for us or, I mean, against us. But we should seek their dua for us. That if Allah would to accept the dua, it will be the dua of your parents. No.
Now,
but he did.
But they did not
remember.
No.
That's haram because he did the action that is haram and he swore, and that's haram. So he should repent. He should repent. It doesn't. There's no joking about it. It's haram. That's why we said no joke. Yes. Last question, fellas. So we have to pray. Okay. No, they won't be held accountable. It's your, because if they make dua and you fail, it's the dua got accepted, but it's still your choice. You did it. They had nothing to do with it. They made dua. That's why Rasulullah said, don't make dua against your children. It was very clear. Because if it gets accepted, yeah, if he would, it would be his choice. Yeah. Juraj was only exposed to it. He was only accused for it. Inshallah, we'll make dua after Salah for one of our mashayikh, Sheikh Muhammad Al-Huwaizi. His wife passed away today, brain cancer. He's in Dallas. Rahmanullah, rahmatan wasi'a. And the Sheikh is very active, mashallah. One of our, so we'll make dua after Aisha, inshallah, for him and his family. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this beautiful gathering, inshallah, to accept our dua for her. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless her. Jannat al-Firdaus. We'll just make it now, inshallah, just because we are here. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulullah. Allahumma laka alhamdu hatta tarda, wa laka alhamdu idha radita, wa laka alhamdu ba'da ridha. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this night, this blessed night, in this gathering, to accept our dua for our sister, Abdullah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to elevate her rank. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make her grave a guardian of paradise. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless her better than what she has left behind, to replace her better than the house that she has left, children better than the children that she has left, to give her the highest level of Jannah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make her grave a garden of Jannah, not to make it as a torture of hellfire. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive all her sins and her mistakes and her shortcomings and to elevate her rank. Allahumma aghfir laha warhamha wa'afiha wa'afu anha. Allahumma akrim nuzulaha wa'assi' mudkhalaha. اللهم نقها من الذنوب والخطايا كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس. اللهم اغسلها من خطاياها بالماء والثلج والبرد. اللهم وسع لها في قبرها مد بصرها وزيادة. اللهم اجعل قبرها روضة من رياض الجنة، ولا تجعله يا ربنا حفرة من حفر النيران. اللهم بعد بينها وبين خطاياها كما بعدت بين المشرق والمغرب. اللهم نقها من الذنوب والخطايا والآثام كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس. اللهم ارفع درجاتها في عليين، ابدلها دارا خيرا من دارها وأهلا خيرا من أهلها. اللهم أكرمها بالجنة وزيادة. ومتعها بالنظر إلى وجهك الكريم، واجعل خير أيامها أول ليلة في قبرها. اللهم اجعل خير أيامها أول ليلة في قبرها. اللهم شفع فيها أعمالها الصالحة، وشفع فيها حفظها لكتابك الكريم. اللهم شفع فيها بشفاعتنا يا أرحم الراحمين، وتقبلها منا إنك على كل شيء قدير. وصبر أهلها، اللهم صبرهم على ما ابتليتهم به، وأنزل عليهم الصبر والسكينة والرضا برحمتك منك وفضل يا أكرم الأكرمين. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد، جزاكم الله خيرا والحمد لله. I think we're going to stop it first. You want to end it first? Is it still on? Yeah.